Good morning. The Lunar New Year holiday is here, and with that come the custom of a gift for your loved ones. Get a look at the special gifts for this year's Seoul holidays. Korea's traditional house, or hanok, is known for its timeless charm and beauty, but the tradition is evolving with that modern touch. The traditional soup for that occasion that emphasizes tradition, dokguk, also known as sliced rice cake soup, is the one dish that you can't miss on Lunar New Year's Day. Seollal activities include this, flying that good old Korean-style kite in the great outdoors. On Korea Today, Lunar New Year's Thursday, February 19th, 2015.
From Arirang News, this is Korea Today.
And a good Lunar New Year's Day morning. Thank you for joining us on Korea Today. I'm Kim Young alongside Oh Jin-joo and Kim Min-jung. And on behalf of Arirang TV, we would like to wish you a Happy New Year.
새해 복 많이 받으세요. That's right. Today is one of Korea's most celebrated national holidays, the Lunar New Year, Seollal. And in spirit of the New Year, we're all dressed in traditional, beautiful traditional hanbok. Especially like what Denny is wearing, pretty in pink.
All right, Denny Hong is joining us as well as Jill McPherson. And we're going to show you some interesting tidbits of our culture on Lunar New Year's Day as well, right?
And from holiday gifts for this year to search words trending online and a look into Korea's traditional hanok and quintessential Seoul dish, dokguk, there's so much in store for us today.
Right, we're going to make your dokguk today, which is a traditional sliced rice cake soup. And it's going to be really good.
Looking forward to that. And Demi,
yes.
You're going to show us some
something to do, you know, outdoors with the family as well too. A very traditional activity, so we're going to talk about kite flying today.
Well, I didn't really see you as that much of a kite flyer.
I enjoy it. I can hold down a very large kite with my body weight.
You sure do have a few surprises there, right?
That's right.
Well, during the national holiday here in Korea, there is a custom of sending gifts. And every year, it's a big headache finding the right gift that is both practical and useful and just really something special and meaningful as well.
That's right. You know, I've already sent some. It's always really difficult to find that special gift. But we are going to set up something just a little bit convenient for you if you haven't chosen that gift yet for those last-minute shoppers out there.
Mm-hmm. For this year, we have some new and unique gift items, so why don't we take a look?
Ahead of the Seoul holiday, traditional markets, big supermarkets, department stores, and convenience stores are all full with holiday gifts on display. The presents range from popular affordable foods and daily necessities to high-end premium gift sets. It's always a big challenge during the holiday season to find the right presents so that our thoughts and appreciation are delivered along with our gifts.
If I consider my parents' health, I think red ginseng would be a good option.
I'm thinking of getting dried persimmons, or traditional Korean sweets called hangwa, which are especially popular among the elderly.
I'm planning on getting my parents' health supplements for the most part.
In a survey asking people what kind of gifts they would get this year, health supplements came in at first, fruit was second, fresh meat ranked third, daily supplies fourth, and clothes came in at fifth on the list. The question of what holiday gifts to buy has been around for a long time, with the preference and trends changing. In the 1950s and 60s, daily necessities like sugar, flour, and other foods were the most popular gift items. During the 70s and 80s, the period of industrialization, goods like coffee and liquor, or fashion items and accessories, were the preferred choice. Coming into the 90s, health supplements like ginseng or special honey came into the spotlight, along with gift vouchers. Since the 2000s, goods such as wine, olive oil, and red ginseng have gained a lot of popularity. Then what kind of gifts are most popular this year? Among other steady sellers, there are some new, unique gift ideas that take into account some of the more recent trends. One department store actually received a lot of attention for demonstrating a holiday gift delivery system using drones.
We prepared this event using drones to show people that new technology can be applied to daily life. Not only that, Kettle products have been popular not just among the younger generation, but older age groups as well. So we planned this event to offer our customers new elements of fun with these unique products for this Hall holiday.
There are various DIY gifts sold at convenience stores through pamphlets that include tech gadgets and some 30 innovative items that you can choose from to create your own gift set.
It was interesting to be able to put together a gift set to suit the taste of the person I'm giving it to. So I think it's great.
You can create your own gift set to suit specific needs by choosing from products such as portable humidifiers powered by USB chargers, mobile phone batteries, and even fitness equipment like a gym ball that will help get you back in shape after digging into a lot of holiday meals.
We prepared various DIY gift sets that customers can create depending on their wide-ranging preferences. We have also a range of small packaged gifts in consideration of single-person households that are growing in size here in the country.
Another convenience store came up with a new gift set that is perfect for the growing singleton population. Organic condiments and mini seasoning for singletons along with small snacks like nuts are some favorites as well. There are also gift options for single people who love their pet companions. Another big trend this year for holiday gifts is desserts, which not only taste good, but are pleasing to the eye. Various desserts like traditional Korean sweets called hangwa, fresh chocolates and cookies have been wrapped in beautiful packaging and transformed into great Seol gifts. Many people still say the best presents for Seol are high-quality gifts. One major trend this year is giving people gourmet foods that wouldn't be consumed on a day-to-day basis. Hanu, or Korean beef sets of the best of quality along with sets combining lobster and abalone are selling well this year. Dried yellow corvina that fetch high prices and traditional alcoholic beverages are also popular items.
In terms of high-quality gifts, a good present is hanu, or Korean beef sets that use premium cuts. Sanyangsang, which is wood-cultivated ginseng, may be very pricey, but it's still popular among those looking for products that are good for your health.
Unique ways of packaging these pricey foods also emerged this year. Some introduced a way of packing the products in the way a book folds in order to enhance practicality. When it comes to sending off fresh abalone, some use Ziploc bags to seal in seawater inside the boxes and attach mini oxygen suppliers to create a small water tank to keep the abalones alive. From unique gifts ideas for some 5 million singletons to sweet desserts that help set aside all your worries and high-quality gifts that are good for your palate and health, how about sending out gifts of gratitude reflecting some of these latest trends for the holiday?
Wow, that was really a huge variety of presents available for this year. And it's really nice to hear that desserts that have been popular since the end of last year have also made a comeback this year, because everyone could use a bit of sugar.
Not me.
Not you, maybe. You know, it's been a lot of preparation for the holidays, so, you know, everyone could use a bit of a sugar rush.
Sure. That's right. The five-day holiday. And the five-day holiday just might have been a holiday for a lot of people, but at the same time, for some people, it's a lot of work getting all that food prepared, right? So there's a gift to chase away the post-holiday blues, especially for the homemakers. That includes you, as well as you helping out everyone in the family. Now, those are hotel packages. Women who have to work a lot before and during the holidays, preparing all the food can get some time off, resting at hotels, and office workers can get some time to kick back as well during this five-week holiday period. Now, hotels are in their off-season during the national holidays, which means that they have the cheaper deals as well. Now, you can enjoy a hotel stay for roughly around 150 to 200 U.S. dollars, which is pretty much cheaper than usual at this time, right? So depending on which package you choose, I would choose the spa package.
Right? Whatever, spa package.
Whatever suits you best from the spa's movies or the delicacies, I think that would make the perfect gift for those wanting to make this more special.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So I think the trend of this year's Seoul holiday can be summed up being more customized and personalized for pet lovers, those living alone or the elderly. But I think the most important thing is to pick the right one for your loved ones, the thing they want, not the thing you want.
Yeah. No chocolates for young.
That's actually an old age-old technique of getting what you want for your loved one. You know, you just buy them what you want and then you use that later on. But you can still call it a gift. You can get away with that, right?
Sure.
Okay, well, there's a lot of different keywords out there that define the holiday seasons and the Lunar New Year holiday itself. So we'll take a look at that and toss things over to Seo Min-sorang.
Good morning, guys. That's right. A lot of Seoul-related topics are trending right now. To begin with, a growing number of families are foregoing this whole tradition of spending time at home with extended family and are instead choosing to go for overseas travel. This year, a record 400,000 people are expected to leave the country through the Incheon International Airport during the Seoul holidays, thanks to the long five-day break, as well as a growing number of budget airlines. But for those that are staying in Korea, here's what they're looking up. First of all, how to do the correct bow or the sebae Lunar New Year bow. So basically in three steps, you stand with your hands together, bow, and then get back up. Sounds simple, but there are two things that you need to remember. So first thing is the position of the hands. So for men, it's left hand over right hand. For women, it's right hand over left. So that's number one. Key point two is at the deepest point of the bow or the lowest point of the bow. For men, the hand touches the ground. For women, the hand remains at shoulder level. So once you have the two points memorized and do a proper bow, children and students might get some sebaedon, whereas adults, usually we tend to exchange gifts. Now, according to a survey by one of the biggest online shopping malls here in Korea, the 1,300 respondents said that they would spend an average amount of a little over $150 for gifts this year. Now, in terms of what they wanted, according to this poll, the number one response was cash and gift cards, a whopping 68% of respondents choosing this, followed by daily necessities or daily supplies at 16% and meat at 14%. Now, that's that. Now, another expenditure during Seoul is the cost of setting up the ancestral rites table. Now, with the same items on the table, the cost can vary depending on when and where you shop. And it's almost always going to be cheaper at traditional markets as opposed to supermarkets. And supermarkets, in turn, are going to be cheaper than department stores. According to an investigation by the Korea Consumer Agency, the same list of 26 common items that go on an ancestral rites table, such as pears, yellow corvines, and beef, it cost around $150 at a traditional market. The same table cost $180 at supermarkets and $240 at department stores. So if you're looking to save some money this Seoul, then shopping at traditional markets is definitely the way to go. And that was a look at what's trending online today. Back to you guys.
All right, thank you very much, Mi-sorang, for a look at those keywords. Pretty interesting. Now, there's an architectural style that has the attributes of class, elegance, and warmth all rolled into one. It's Korea's Hanok, exemplified by the Gyeowa-jip, or tile-roofed homes, and also the Chogajip, the thatched-roof homes.
That's right. And of the two, the tile-roofed Gyeowa-jip is seeing a resurgence in interest and a value as modern Koreans look at that and really appreciate its timeless beauty and charm.
Right. Let's take a look at how the traditional Korean home Hanok, characterized by its slender and flowing lines, is being reinterpreted to fit today's lifestyles.
Hanok! You can only find them in Korea. Pukchon Hanok Village has solidified its spot as one of the must-visit sites when in Seoul, so I decided to take some time to breathe in its beauty and ask some visitors about their thoughts along the way.
For me, this style of houses, it's new. I have a chance to know a little bit about the Korean traditions, really Korean culture. And I really like very much this kind of houses.
It will feel really comfortable to live inside, really warm. So nice view.
Hanoks have been around for thousands of years in Korea, and it's a huge part of Korea's history. But recently, there has been a transitional phase for Hanok homes. Let's find out more about what this big change is all about.
A sprawling lot of over 56,000 square meters, it's a Hanok village under construction in Eunpyeonggu, Seoul. You can find the so-called modern Hanok homes here, creating a neighborhood the first of its kind. On the outside, it may be a traditional Korean home, but when you walk in, it has all the comforts and amenities of your contemporary residence. You can really see the collaboration of the traditional and the modern, as the structure does not lose any of the innate style that a Hanok holds.
이거는 뭐예요? TV인가요?
외부에서 손님이 왔을 때 인터폰을 할 수 있다든지 아니면 뭐 노래를 듣는다든지 그런 같은 걸 할 수 있나요?
On the outside, it looks like just a traditional Hanok house, but it has all of the essential things you need in a kitchen.
The Hanok was designed to suit the lifestyle of Koreans in the years preceding the 20th century. The kitchen was set aside because of the dangers of fire to the wooden architecture, and the way the home was heated was also much different from now.
When people think of Hanoks, the prevailing thought is that they're old-fashioned. For example, they think heating is going to be inconvenient. So you can say that we've improved on those points by modernizing these Hanoks.
Not only are Hanoks being renovated to be used as places of everyday living, they're also seeing new life as commercial space. This is a designer showroom that limelights simple yet distinct jewelry, such as rings for couples. In the Samcheongdong neighborhood of Seoul, there's a wedding shop that's set up in what was a small and aged Hanok. The shop owner kept the original rafters and window panes for their distinctive interior effect. Not only does it serve as a point of conversation, but consumers are also pleased with the pleasant ambiance of a Hanok.
Curiosity is what initially brought me in. Maybe it's because the wedding shop is inside a Hanok. It feels very homey getting a consultation here.
The charm of a Hanok is also sought by proprietors of cafes and restaurants. It offers something different to franchises, a distinct allure that customers can immerse themselves in.
I was thinking about the architecture. I like the buildings. How they look, I guess. It's interesting because we don't sit on the floor back home at all. And so it's very nice, it's charming.
So we decided to take a poll. We went to the Language Institute at Sungkyunkwan University and asked the students there, at the same cost, which of the four lodging options would you go for? Which do you think received the best response?
I think when you go to a country for the first time, it's important to experience the traditional house, how it's built, how it's meant to be shown as the country's tradition.
Because I think if you come to Korea, you need to experience the Korean culture, and a Korean house is only in Korea, so you may as well stay in a very traditional house rather than a hotel, which can be in any other country.
This is Lagung, Korea's first high-end Hanok hotel. It kicked off the era of Hanok hotels when it opened in 2007, and if Lagung is a hotel constructed through modern methods but dressed in Hanok sensibilities, Gurume is a collection of seven renovated Hanoks that served as actual residences to Korea's ruling class Yangbans in the 17th to 19th century. The homes were modernized while preserving their exterior form. Also in Seoul's very own Pukchon neighborhood, famed for its many Hanoks, you can find a growing number of remodeled Hanoks that welcome guests. So we visited one of these homes.
Hello. 네, 네, 감사합니다.
Aren't you curious as to what kind of room it is? Let's go.
Wonder what it looks like inside?
Ooh, fancy.
The harmony of the past and present molded into the facility was impressive, but I was particularly uplifted by the calming scent of pine trees wafting indoors. This hotel also features a modernized ondor, Korea's traditional underfloor heating system.
Oh, it's so warm. I could fall asleep right now.
지금 잠을 잘 자고 올 것 같아.
The hotel's main clients visit from other countries. We caught up with a couple taking pictures in traditional Hanbok clothing on loan from the hotel.
Why did you choose this Hanok style accommodation?
Because it's my first time for my girlfriend's coming to Korea. So I thought that this could be a perfect place for me to give a good experience, a special experience.
What was most surprising here was the ondor. I've never slept on a heated floor, so it was very interesting and nice.
This hotel offers other experiences too. You can experience Korean tea culture in a special tea ceremony.
So as well as enjoying the Hanok experience, you can experience all different sorts of Korean culture.
Hanok has been the stage for Korean life for the past centuries. What other forms will it take in the years to come?
Now, from a place of residence to commercial spaces of various kinds, Hanok has really come a long way, and I'm suddenly very proud to be living in the Hanok.
You lucky bum.
Now, did you guys know that the see, Hanok combines the architectural aspects from the north and the south, ondor coming from the north, and the wooden flooring coming from the south? And it's really rare to find this type of architecture in any parts of the world that combines these two different aspects.
Mm-hmm. And that does show a little bit about the wisdom of the ancestors in Korea. Now it's time to, now it's undergoing another transformation with the modern construction technologies, putting the modern along with the traditions together. Now coupled with the comforts of today's best high-tech wizardry, the unique Korean Hanok can perhaps soon find fans all over the world.
That's right. All right, well, still ahead on Korea Today, there is a dish that all Koreans will enjoy today, and that's tteokguk, of course. With the New Year holidays, the hearty bowl of rice cakes will be served in each and every household. Where does this tradition come from, and how do you make tteokguk? Joe McPherson cooks it up for us in the studio, so don't go away. K-pop is not the only thing that is catching people's attention around the world. These days, a growing number of foreigners are showing more interest in Korea's traditional music called gugak as well. And there are a couple of foreign professors who took their love for Korean gugak to a whole new level and pursued their careers in the field.
That's right. Joining us this morning are Hillary Fincham Sung, a Korean music professor at Seoul National University, and also a kayagam player, also a professor at Paejae University, Jocelyn Clark joining us. Good morning.
Good morning.
And it sounded beautiful. Thank you so much. Okay, now we see a lot of people around the world that are involved in Korean studies or instructing Korean or getting into anything in Korean, but this is Korean traditional music that you've gotten involved in. Tell us how you first got started.
Well, I actually started in with other types of East Asian music, specifically with the Japanese koto, which is very similar to the kayagam. It's what they call in Japan, shiragi koto. This is what this is called. So shilagum instead of kayagum. And then I spent some time in China at the Nanjing Academy of the Arts studying the zheng, which is the jang in Korean. And then I heard that there was something similar in Korea called the kayagum, and I came to Korea, actually specifically to study the kayagum in 1992.
Okay, how did you begin?
Well, it was really about the sound. I was a graduate student at Indiana University studying ethnomusicology, which is the study of the connection between music and people's lives. I came upon a recording of Southwestern Shinawe, which is shaman ensemble accompaniment music. And the sound just blew me away. And I went and told my professor that I really just, the sound was nothing, something like nothing I'd ever heard before. She looked at me and she said, why don't you then think about pursuing Korean music? Because they were wanting me to focus on a world area and I was wanting to be free, but it doesn't really work for a graduate student to do that. So it kind of, the sound itself just sort of pointed me in that direction. And also my professor sort of pushed me. So it was the sound. Yeah, the sound itself, it was really raw right now because we weren't really ready to play. The sound itself is very raw and very earthy and kind of rustic.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what attracted me to Korean music.
Mm. Yeah. Now, I was going to ask you why you chose these specific instruments. Mm-hmm. I think I already found the answers. The instruments found you almost. And it's very interesting because the sound has the very the Korean emotion of Han. I think that very subtle kind of sadness in it too as well. How did you, as a foreigner studying the instruments, how did you grasp the meaning of Han and also just how were you able to incorporate that in your performances?
Well, I'll address this first. First thing is, there's a word for it in Korean, and if you translate Han into English, it's basically unrequited grief, unrequited sorrow, unrelinquished pain, a variety of those ideas. I think everybody in the world feels those things, and everybody in the world has a different word or idea that is attached to that. In Korea, there's a concept that is attached to nationalism, which is Han. But Korean music, I think for a long time, especially because not many people are familiar with it, think that it expresses only Han, but it expresses joy, excitement, overwhelming joy, but also sadness and peace. There are a lot of things that Korean music and instruments themselves, the sounds they can create, can embody. And in a way, not to discount your question, but Han is a little bit overrated as the thing that Korean music expresses. It expresses much more than that. It's very much connected to all the emotions and ways that we live our lives.
Mm.
Yeah, but as a foreigner, of course, I feel pain, I feel anguish, and I feel all those things that also Koreans feel. There are emotional aspects of playing the instruments that you learn how to express through certain melodic characteristics and ornamentations that you learn as you just go along.
Okay, well, Jocelyn, let me point this question towards you. Both of you actually have experience teaching students, right, in a Korean traditional instrument. And as expats and foreigners, you bring something else to the table, a different sort of view, something that might be even beyond tradition, right? How does your students gather your teachings, and how are you received? How's your lessons received by the students?
Well, actually, I'm teaching in the International Studies department, and so I only have a few classes in the music department, and my focus in the music department is teaching Western music majors. So none of my students are going on to, you know, focus on Korean traditional music, but I do talk to composers and then a lot of piano majors and also pop music, those who are going on to pop music. So what I try to do with especially like those who are studying singing songwriting or pop music is focus on elements that they can bring to their performance as Korean students that can inform their sort of what they're going to do as professional performers. So in the pop music realm, we really focus on Korean rhythm patterns, especially the faster ones that can help them. So I usually give them assignments like, you know, come up with a pop song and use this rhythm pattern, something like that, and they can perform it in class. Also, we look at the different modes, as Hillary was discussing regarding Han. Of course, all musics have different modal expressions that, you know, are supposed to express happiness or sadness. Korea has all these things. Western music has all these things. So I try to, show the similarities in terms of emotional content. You know, minor modes could equal Kaemyeonjo in Korea, or major mode can be like Pyeongjo or Jo, one of these other modes that is less sort of heartbreaking sounding. But I'm also, next to music, I'm also teaching philosophy and literature and film and all sorts of other things that aren't really necessarily related to Korean music. But another class I teach is comparative aesthetics of East Asia. So in that class, we really talk about, you know, what is the meaning of Han. If we're talking about Japan, we can talk about Mono no Aware. If we're talking about Turkey, we can talk about Hutsun. There's all these words that, you know, that are express the same things across culture and how those things are a little bit different and how they're also the same.
I'm afraid we're out of time for today, but you ladies look beautiful in hanbok, and that
you sounded great
performance
too.
Is absolutely beautiful. Thank you so much for joining us and sharing your insight.
Thank you. Still ahead on this Lunar New Year's Day special of Korea Today, one of Korea's traditional pastimes has been flying kites. And what are some of the features that are unique to Korean kites? We get a look at the fun and traditions behind Korea's kite flying culture, including the kite battles that we have.
And joining us here on Korea Today is that character, Ted Ching, the character who's known as the super fan for the Next in Heroes. Thanks for joining us, Ted.
Thanks for having me. Happy New Year, SJ.
Happy New Year's to you. I know this is a question a lot of people ask, baseball fans, not just the Next in Heroes fans, but you know, just baseball fans here in Korea. How'd you go about coming up with this Ted Ching character? How did you come up being a super fan for the Next in Heroes?
How did I come up with the character? Well, first of all, I think the Ted Ching character, the myth of Ted Ching, was something that people on the internet made before even I was aware of it.
So the internet made this?
Yeah, the internet gave me the nickname Ted Ching, and also Nek Tong Young, the president of Nexen. I had my picture taken at games without my knowledge of it, and sometimes screenshots of me put on TV, and they would be put on internet geishipan sites. And people started calling me the Nek Tong Young, the Ted Ching. There's a variety of nicknames and a whole sort of mythos around me before I even knew that I was being talked about.
Right. I mean, obviously people call you Nek Tong Young for a reason, right? I mean, you have gone to numerous games out there. I mean, how many games have you actually gone to this past season? And have you counted all the games that you've gone throughout your career?
Oh, it was hard to keep track, so I eventually started doing a sort of accounting spreadsheet for it. But the short story is 3 years in a row, I'm a member of the Nexen Century Club.
So more than 100
games. And there's
games.
Only two of us the last 3 years. More than 100 games for the last three seasons. So I think the total count as of this year was somewhere in the range of 350 games.
350 games?
In four seasons.
In the past three seasons?
And they don't pay me to do that.
Well, obviously you're a super fan for being able to do this and all, but during the off season, I mean, there's no games, obviously so cold. The players are over in Arizona where it's nice and warm. What do you do during the off season?
Well, last season, I actually went all the way to spring training camp in Arizona. I have some relatives there, and so under the guise of going and visiting my distant family, I stopped by and watched a couple of games, spring training exercises. And then I was in Okinawa for the past 2 years.
Right.
Unfortunately, I couldn't go this year because of my book, which I guess we'll talk about in a little bit.
Right, let's talk about this book that you have. I mean, Famous.
It's called Famous, and it's available in fine bookstores everywhere. Thank you for the plug.
This is an autobiography of yourself, and is it necessarily about you as a Nexen super fan, or what is it? Is it just generally on baseball?
I wouldn't call it an autobiography. I mean, I left out a lot of the usual autobiographical tropes. I didn't talk about my childhood and being picked on by other kids, which led me to create this personality or this cult of mystique. No, it's mostly just a memoir, a travel memoir, if you will, of the last 4 years, 3 years, first 3 years that I spent in Korea.
The 350 plus games that you're able to attend, right?
And what happened to me here, how it is that I was able to quit being an English teacher and then become a sort of full-time fan, and the transformation that I underwent personally during that process.
You know, when it comes to the KBO, obviously a huge rise in popularity when it comes to the KBO here in Korea, but not just amongst Koreans, but foreign fans. You are one of the few foreign fans that kind of stand out. Do you bump into other foreign fans who kind of want to be the next Ted Ching or anyone like that?
Well, I think if there's anyone who can give me a run for my money, it's Luke.
This is over the Howling Eagles.
Yeah, who is a large, muscular, bearded, Thor-like or maybe Zeus-like individual who is almost always at the Hanwha home games and very visible. We ran into each other last year in Chengdu first, and we had just beaten the stuffing out of him like 13-4 or something, so he wasn't in a mood for talk. But then we met again later in the fall and became friends. So yeah, there's kind of a solidarity or a kind of expatriate community within the expatriate community of hardcore baseball fans. So there's maybe about half a dozen of us, and we all know each other pretty well.
Ted, it's new Lunar New Year's, obviously New Year's and Seollal for all of us here in Korea. You have a lot of fans yourself. You're a fan of the Nexon Heroes, but if you could send out any message out to your fans or just the team that you root for, what would you say?
I would say our spring has finally come. This is the year we're going to be the champions.
All right. Once again, you guys came close last year with the Samsung Lions, but hopefully you guys can take it this year even without Kang Jong-ho.
Promised myself I wouldn't cry, but I ended up doing it anyways. Hey.
Well, I'm pretty sure we've seen you cry numerous times, even when the Nexon Heroes made the playoffs too, right?
Oh, that was that was famous. The so-called crying selfie, as it's been labeled.
Or the Crygate.
Yeah.
Well, Ted, once again, well, best of luck to you in the new season. I'm pretty sure you're going to be rooting for them. Another century mark this season as well.
Here's hoping.
That's right. Best of luck to you, and thank you very much for joining us here on Korea Today.
Thanks, Chief. Thanks so much for having me.
All right, once again, that's our super fan for the Nexon Hero, Ted Ching, joining us here on Korea Today. It's really cold today.
It's all right.
The one dish you must have on Seoul holiday is dokguk. The saying has been for countless years that you have to have your bowl of dokguk in order to add a year to your age. So come New Year, Koreans always eat dokguk. Records dating back to the Joseon Dynasty even spell out that one's age is equivalent to the number of bowls of dokguk you have consumed. The main ingredient for dokguk is garaejeok, which produces rice cakes in long, thin strips. The lengthy rice cake carries a message of longevity, and naturally the dish made with garaejeok came to symbolize one's age. The sliced duck in the soup also resembles coins from the past, and for this reason is also said to be a dish hoping for affluence. Dokguk is also a dish that can serve as an energy booster. The rich broth that's served with beef and egg garnish adds protein, creating a hearty meal for all to enjoy. These days, the broth is not only cooked with meat, there are a number of others that people can pick and choose from, showing the dish is evolving with the times. Dokguk is a dish enjoyed by countless people across the country, from the young to the elderly, bringing everyone together to celebrate the spirit of Seoul. We'll get started now to put some dokguk on your table.
All right, joining us is Joe McPherson to give us his expertise on dok, or glutinous rice cake, and that is a very staple part of the Korean traditional dish for Lunar New Year's. Good morning.
Good morning. Yes, it is very traditional. In fact, you can't have said you have gotten older without having your bowl of dokguk.
That's right. I used to eat two bowls thinking that I would get 2 years older, but it doesn't work like that.
Yeah.
One bowl, 1 year, two bowl, 1 year, three bowl, 1 year.
These days, that's my excuse to not eat it, but that's right. I still find myself eating it.
So we're like, okay, how about we just eat half, right? Okay, so this is exactly how it comes out. They put it through a presser.
Right.
And basically, this is the work that you get, right?
Right, so this is sticky rice that has been pounded until it's a nice mush, and then extruded through a machine. So it comes out of this nice tube. And what we do is we slice that, and that's called garaejeok.
Yep, this is garaejeok. And we do slice it into little tiny pieces. So why don't you go ahead and show us
all
exactly
right.
how to do that.
Let me cut this one in half. The trick is you gotta have it at the right consistency. And usually when you get garaejeok, it's really soft. So.
Yeah.
And then it gets really hard. So the trick is, well, where's the magic time? And the trick I've heard a lot from a mother-in-law is let it sit overnight.
Oh, let it sit overnight. So because it is so soft, you want it to harden just a little bit so it can
right.
hold up the knife cutting it. And then they always cut it in this diagonal fashion.
Yeah, try
like
to get it at that diagonal thing. The first cut's not going to get it, but they'll get like that.
Okay, but you can still eat it.
Yeah, and it's still fun to eat while you cook. You don't need to pre-cook it or anything.
Okay, so for the traditional dokguk, you want to cook it in, you want to cut it into these little shapes, right?
Right.
You can see how they're diagonally cut. And these are a little bit harder than the ones that we were playing with.
And they're supposed to look like coins. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of symbolism in Korea when it comes to New Year. You want luck. And so you get a lot of coin imagery. You get a lot of symbolism with colors. Mm-hmm. And also, just garaedok itself is considered a luxurious item traditionally because it requires a lot of rice to make it. Mm-hmm. And when rice was scarce, only the very rich were able to eat this.
Okay, so now we have garaedok that comes like that. You can also cook it like this. Basically, is this fried or
It's usually roasted, grilled. The places I usually see it are in traditional tea houses and rest stops when you're on the highway.
Exactly. What you can do
I love this.
You can dip that. This is honey, right?
This is starch syrup.
Okay.
No, that's what you dip it in.
Okay, And you can dip it in that and go ahead.
I love that stuff.
It's really good.
To me, it's like fire roasted popcorn. Mm-hmm.
It sure is good. And then you can see over here, we just want to get this real quick. They do come in different colors as well.
Right.
Yeah. So we just want to show you that it does come in different colors. And this is the modern dakguk these days. So we actually have the garnishes and all these other different garnishes that's in there, right?
Right.
So we're going to go ahead and have some dakguk by Joe. So Joe's going to go ahead and make some of that for us later on in our show. Minjung?
Thank you, Young. That garaedok looks really good.
Mm-hmm. And we're looking forward to that dakguk later in the show. And moving on, one of Korea's traditional pastimes during the Seoul holidays is flying kites. I've tried it before, but it's quite difficult because you have to know where the wind is coming from.
And the kite always ends up getting stuck on
a
tree.
Right. But our Denny Hong joins us to tell us how to fly the kite.
Good morning, Denny.
Good morning. And my kite never got stuck in a tree.
Somebody tells me you're good at kite flying.
But yes, we are going to be talking about flying traditional kites. And now they're a little bit different. Of course, kite flying is a culture that's all around the world. But we're going to be looking a little bit at the unique aspects of Korean kite flying. So let's take a look.
Flying kites is known as yeonnalligi in Korea. It's a pastime enjoyed not only here, but in many other countries, and was designated Intangible Cultural Heritage No. 4 in 1992 by the Seoul City government. The traditions behind kites continue to this day, and we'll look at some of the stories that they carry with them. This is the Korean Kite Preservation Association. Ahead of the New Year holiday, there are many gathered here to make traditional kites. You can get a look at a variety of them and also try your hand at it, making the event popular with many. Kites are said to have been born from mankind's hope of flying. Flying them is a form of entertainment enjoyed all across the world, but it's hard to pinpoint exactly when it all started. This is because the materials used to make them were mainly paper and hard to preserve, and there are not many detailed records.
The first records for kites in Korea were found in the Chronicles in the Three States, where it mentions General Kim Yushin used kites to conquer rebels. Those are the first records available, but I think they would have existed long before that in order for them to have used kites in combat.
As you can tell, flying kites began a long time ago. They're found not only in Korea, but all over the world. So it's not a practice unique to the country, but the method of flying them differs depending on where you are. China and Thailand focus on how high you can fly the kites and the beauty and glamour of it. While in Japan, it's all about the size and bringing the community together while creating it. Korea has yet another underlying culture that can be explained through the characteristics of the kite. Korea's traditional kites are categorized into roughly 100 different kinds, but in terms of shape, there's the gaoryeon that are shaped like a stingray or a diamond, and pangpaeon that are rectangular. The diamond-shaped kite is easy to make and comes with great stability. This is why it's used all across the world, but there is a distinctive trait the Korean gaoryeon comes with.
In the case of the gaoryeon, it has a long tail attached. Most kites in other countries don't have this tail, and in many cases, they lack the fins on the side.
The tails on the gaoryeon balance air resistance on either side, making the kite a lot easier to control. But what truly sets Korean kites apart from others is the pangpaeon.
Hangpaeon can be found in other countries and are unique to Korea. In other places, they may use the shape of birds or fishes that are easier to make. But Korea, interestingly, has been making these shield-shaped kites and flying it.
The Hangpaeon comes with 5 rods for support. The width and length are set at the secret ratio of 2-3. The hole in the middle is unique to Korean kites. This feature lets the strong winds flow through and carries the kite better so that it can be more easily manipulated.
This hole in the middle allows the kite to be controlled up and down and left to right. In the case of other kites, they're mostly about flying them high and far, making it hard to use for kite fights, but the fights in Korea can get pretty fun.
This is an important feature that led to the birth of kite fights. A kite fight is when 2 kites fly against each other and try to cut the opponent's string. In order to have a better hand at cutting the strings, some would crush glass into fine powder and add it to a mixture of glue applied to the strings. But what was considered more important than the strength of the string itself was the ability to manipulate the kite with greater accuracy. In the past, some would climb hills in the wintertime to master their skills to be used in kite fights. Kites were not only for fun and entertainment, though. In the new year, people would fly off kites to do away with any bad fortune looming ahead. They would write the letters for ill luck on the kite along with their date of birth and name, and set their kites free into the sky, or set them on fire to burn.
In the new year, there's a custom of wishing people good luck, and during the full moon celebration, people ward off bad fortune. People would write the words 송액연복 on kites and fly them off into the sky, with the belief that it would send off ill luck and bring in good fortune.
Kites may have been part of rituals or games in the past, but now they have become a means of creative expression, with artists putting out works of art in the form of kites. In whatever shape they are in, kites still carry people's hopes and desires. So how about flying a kite carrying your wishes for the new year high up into the sky?
These are really interesting looking kites. Wow. Beautiful. Now, Danny, is there a reason we associate kite flying with winter? I've seen people do it more so in the winter than summer.
Well, this one actually goes more to the Korean traditional past. So as a traditional farming society, they kind of wanted to have the kite flying happen on the off season of when they're actually farming or harvesting. And this is partly because the culture of kite flying, it goes to the idea of warding off bad luck for the farming season. And so they wanted to make sure that didn't interfere some other way too. And so in this sense, the beginning of the kite flying season traditionally was mid-December to about New Year's on the lunar calendar, and also on the very first full moon. So the Jeongwol Daebodeum was also a time to fly kites. But again, they wanted to avoid the farming season just in case the luck warding off interfered.
Right. So the Lunar New Year day would be the highlight, would be the peak of the season, the kite flying season, huh?
That's right.
Right, and when it comes to kite flying, we can't leave out kite fights. They used to coat the string with various things to make it more stiff to win the fight against someone. But I didn't know that a rectangular 방패연 is much more easier to manipulate the kite.
Well, if you look at the 방패연, basically, in this sense, the central hole here is because you want to get rid of wind resistance when it comes to stronger winds, right? Because if you have something that's a little bit larger and something that's stronger when you are kite fighting, you don't want it to, I guess, interfere too much. And so to be able to control it better, the central hole for the wind resistance, as well as when it comes to, I guess, the rapid movements you're allowed to make, whether it's, you know, any direction, up, down, sideways, right? So this is actually a very scientific design for, you know, kite flying as well,
right,
too.
And these days you can easily buy kites, plastic kites at the stores, but, you know, there is a beautiful tradition of making kites, and this one, I believe, is made by an artisan. You know, it has a stamp and everything. Tell us a little bit about making kites.
Okay, traditionally, when it comes to the paper, it's made from paper from the mulberry bark, and when it comes to the framework, those rods are made from bamboo. Now, when it comes to the string, it could be either cotton or silk, but usually they're starch because you want them to be a little bit stronger so they don't break when they are resisting in the wind as well, too. And so, you know, that's the basic idea. And also, the most important thing is the kite reel, because you can have the most beautiful kite, the most beautiful string, but if your reel is wrong, then it's kind of just breaks somewhere.
Right. A quick question, Denny. Mm-hmm. Is there a standard size for a kite?
There's no standard size. It just depends on how old you are, what kind of kite you can handle. If you are in high winds, you want something a little bit smaller, right? If you want a, I guess, someplace with more calmer winds, something larger so that it has more to grab onto as well, too.
I say the bigger the better.
Then you should have more heavier people holding those.
You know, it's a great way to burn off the calories that you've accumulated over the holidays, especially with all the dakguk dishes that you eat. And our young is almost done with, or he is about to start cooking dakguk. So let's take it over to him. Young.
All right, thank you very much, Minjung. Now, we have everything ready on the go, so we can show you exactly how long it really does take to cook all this stuff up.
Here we go. After you get your garnishes set up, it is really fast to make your dakguk. First, we're just going to fry our beef and garlic.
Okay, that beef is ground beef along with garlic, right?
Ground beef, chopped garlic, and we're just going to fry this until it is nice and brown. It should just take us 1 minute or so.
And then while we do that, we can just go ahead and get the broth going.
Yeah, we'll get the broth going. Now, what we have today is beef bone broth, which is the heartier kind of dakguk, but you can also make it with anchovies, dried anchovies. And there are different places around Korea that do different types of broths. Traditionally, it was pheasant broth.
So you can actually put pheasant broth in there, but it's turned
chicken,
over to beef now.
You can do that as well.
Okay, should we add the duck right now? When should we add the duck?
Yeah, let's go ahead and add the duck right now. Do you want the color stuff or you want the white stuff?
No, let's go with the traditional.
All right.
I'm gonna go ahead and just use my hands on
this.
The
rainbow duck.
How much should I put in? Last time I put too much noodles.
That's enough. Okay. That's enough. Because it does get a little starchy, and you don't want to cook it for too long. That's another thing about having it just right, is you don't want it to get too soggy. You still want a little bit of firmness to it, because it will still cook a bit and soften while it's in the bowl.
So would you say a good 4 minutes or 3 minutes? 3 to 4 minutes?
Yeah,
is good
around
enough?
Yeah, 2 minutes, 3 minutes. Doesn't need that long at all.
Okay, so let's see. As you're doing the
beef there,
you know, it's been about maybe a minute and a half or so since we did put in the duck, and you can already see that it's very, very soft, right? It's good enough to eat there. All right, perfect.
I can see you getting older already.
Oh, it's ready to go.
All right, well, this is almost ready. And what we do is, since we're finishing that up, at the very end of cooking, we want to add our onions, because we want our onions to still be a little bit crispy.
So in here?
Yeah, add it in here. Okay. Add it in here. Because you know, that good beef broth with green onions, that's a good
half,
green.
Half, would
you say? Yeah, half. And let's put in a little bit of the soy sauce. I've tasted the broth and it's a little salty, but still a little bit of soy sauce would help.
Is that enough?
There we go, that'll be good. There we go, this is about ready. And you just give that another minute. It is so fast. It is so easy once you have this all set up.
Oh, it smells so good.
It smells great. This is smelling good too. Here we go. All right, beef is about done.
Okay.
All right.
So the beef is surprisingly what takes the longest. The duck, it just cooks in a matter of minutes.
Everything, you gotta work fast. Well, but you got hungry kids. They want their dakguk. All right, so as always, I'm just throwing everything around the table. So what you do, how you prep, ladle yourself a nice little bowl.
So we want a lot of duck. You guys want a lot of duck, Minjung and Jinju, right?
Yeah, a lot of duck.
All right.
She wants to get a little bit older than that.
She looks
so
young. Are we ready? Can we come over?
Yeah, wow. We're getting it done.
All right.
There we go.
That was quick.
And let's do a little bit of...
The first dakguk that I'm having, first bowl of dakguk. I'll probably end up having 5 more bowls this holiday.
Here, just put that in the middle. Get some of our eggs. We have some egg yolk here.
Oh yeah, I cannot.
I'm just
going to
use my fingers. They are clean.
Mm-hmm. We need to have the seaweed.
And we need
I actually
seaweed.
Prefer not to have the seaweed. Oh,
okay.
Some people go with or without, you know. I think in my opinion, it gets a little murky with.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, so. Be careful. The bowl is hot. Here we go. I'm just going to place some of that in the middle.
Great. Wow.
All right, want that right there.
You know, and it's funny because each household has different ways of cooking.
Oh, yeah. We put mandu.
Do you?
Yeah.
We don't put mandu, but we just have different garnishes, just a little bit different. You know, it's the essential ingredients are the same.
Right.
But
some households put in hongap or mussels in there.
Right.
That's true.
Closer to the ocean, they do. And Gangwon province tends to be more mandugook. They like the dumplings in
yeah,
there.
Yeah, exactly.
And then, North Korea as
yeah,
well.
North Korea. So and my
North
parents
Korea.
Actually come from there. So what they do is they don't even get the mandu and eat it whole. They just start breaking up in
oh,
like eating
mandu.
And then they
good.
Just go ahead and eat it like that. It's really
this
good.
This is in North Korea.
This is North Korean style.
And they also use smaller, bouncier dok.
Yeah.
All How's right. that? Jinju. So?
What do you think of Joe's cooking?
It's really good.
That's a real question. What do you think of Joe's cooking?
It's a combined really effort.
All right. I'm sure all of our viewers are enjoying their tteokguk as you're watching us. Well, this is where you say goodbye on this 설날. Oh, it's been a great show today.
Sure. As well. We're going to enjoy this tteokguk, and we hope you are too, at the comfort of your own homes. We'll see you back here tomorrow morning at 7 a.m.
Happy Lunar New Year.
Goodbye.